Well, the oil and gas free zone authority was created essentially under previous administrations, I think the Obasanjo's administration back then, to ensure that the oil and gas ease of doing business in Nigeria's oil-rich Niger Delta gets the best that they could be. So the OGFZ, that's the acronym for the Oil and Gas Free Zone Authority, has been operating since then and recently got the PEBEC, that's the Presidential Enabling Business Council, as the best in terms of ease of doing business. So let's talk to the Managing Director and CEO for GEFZA, Umana Okon. Umana is live to us from our Abuja studios. Good morning, Managing Director. It's good to have you here, sir.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. We appreciate your time. It's a public holiday for everyone, both in public and private sector. So for you as a government official to be here, we appreciate this very much. So let's talk about GEFZA, just a little bit of a background for this oil and gas free zone authority.
Well, thank you very much. The Oil and Gas Free Zones Authority, of course, is a product of law. It was established by Act number 8 of 1996, and then commenced operations and went ahead to establish free zones that focus on oil and gas activities and operations. Our flagship free zone is the Oil and Gas Free Zone. We also have the Eco Support Free Zone in Lagos. There's the Warri Free Zone. And then recently we also licensed the Noturi Free Zone. So primarily our mandate is to regulate and manage free trade zones that focus on oil and gas operations with the primary objective of attracting foreign direct investments into our free zones. And of course, you know, with the attraction of foreign direct investments, Nigeria will benefit from creation of employment, generation of revenues, transfer of technology and skills. And the records will bear us out. I believe so far so good. We've done very well.
In terms of what the GEFZA has been able to achieve, we all know oil and gas is the Nigeria's economic underbelly. So you're holding a very critical part of that, working with everyone within the petroleum resources and the entire industry, oil and gas industry as a whole. So let us a little bit into what you do. Like you've talked about licensing new areas of business. But again, in terms of the other MDAs, businesses, private sector, government agencies that you work with.
Well, thank you very much. In terms of structure, we are under the Ministry of Industry, Trade and Investment, even though we focus on free trade zones, they focus on oil and gas activities. But the emphasis is on trade promotion, investment promotions. That is why we are under the Ministry of Industry, Trade and Investments. And to attract foreign direct investments, we provide incentives for our investors. These incentives are founded on law. They range from fiscal incentives, which cover exemptions from all forms of taxes, federal, states, and local governments. We also have immigration incentives, customs incentives, so that our clients and investors who operate within the free zones can have their requests for customs approvals expeditiously dealt with, requests for STR visas, which should be dealt with by the immigration authorities. That too will be expeditiously dealt with. So within the free zone, we operate as a one-shop, one-stop shop. So our clients will not have to go anywhere else to look for approvals because we have a full customs presence, a full immigration presence. So all their requests are dealt with expeditiously. And you know, the whole idea of having a free zone is to make life easy for investors. That is the whole concept of the free zone globally. And therefore, the incentives are provided so that we can be globally competitive, compete with other free zones around the world and attract foreign direct investments into Nigeria. So, and that is why when I took over as managing director in the last quarter of 2016, we took a number of steps to create the enabling environment to attract foreign direct investments. We had the management retreat in January 2017, and after that retreat, we produced a roadmap which we launched in February 2017. That roadmap had a number of goals, one of which was to create an enabling environment, because if you must attract foreign direct investments, you must offer something that will bring them into our free zones in Nigeria. And then we also set a goal for ourselves of growing investments into our free zones. We had a target of 30 to 50% over 3 years. And then there was also the goal of improving operational efficiency within the zones. And then we also had the goal of effective communication. We felt we needed to have a strong presence, not just in Nigeria, but globally. Because I met an agency that really had no name recognition. And so we had to bring the agency to life against the background of what we have to do so that the global community of investors will take note and understand that we offer an attractive investment destination in terms of the free trade zone. So we did all of that, and we had that roadmap launched in February 2017, several months before the executive order 001, which focuses on the promotion of transparency and efficiency in the business environment in Nigeria. So we were ahead of the federal government on this matter of making life easy for investors. So when the order was issued, and I'd like to speak very briefly to give you an insight into what that order is all about. I've already said it is about promoting transparency and efficiency in the business environment. Basically, five planks of that order. The first plank had to do with transparency itself. And to achieve transparency, a number of directives were issued. The primary directive was that all MDAs should publish a list of their services and products, requirements, and conditions for their clients to obtain that the services and products, the fees they will charge, and publish all that on their websites, and also have that pasted in their business premises. Because if your clients don't even know what you offer, and under what terms, and under what conditions, then there's no transparency. And they were also to publish a list of timelines for the delivery of the various services and products. And as I said, because we started early, where we had taken proactive steps even before the executive order was issued, because one of our goals in our roadmap was to improve operational efficiency. So we, on the matter of timelines, we came up with a number of timelines. In the past, it would take several weeks or even months to obtain a license, even when the applicant or the company in question had met all the conditions. We set a timeline of 14 days, where once the application is submitted and all conditions are met, it would take 14 days to issue the license. It would take only 3 days to renew an existing license, again, when all the requirements have been met. And then it would take a maximum of 48 hours for us to deal with all operational requests. You must understand that our flagship free zone, the oil and gas free zone, for example, is also a logistics center that supports the operations of the oil and gas industry. So time is of the essence. So when cargoes come in, we give a timeline that's within 48 hours, maximum of 48 hours, working with the customs, Nigerian Customs Service, all requests will be treated, dealt with, and the approval given. So, and second plank of that order had to do with default approval. And by default approval, the federal government directed that where you have stipulated your time frame and you've stated the services you offer and the requirements, when there's an application, if you don't treat that application within the time frame you have given, when that timeline lapses, then the application will be deemed to have been approved, even if you had not reacted. And the applicants can then write to the higher authority, maybe to your minister, to obtain some documentary support for the approval. And the officer who had to act on the request will be sanctioned. So that is the second plank, which has to do with what is called default approval. And the whole idea is to accelerate the approval process. The third plank of the executive order 001 had to do with the concept of one government. You know, for too long, government agencies had operated in silos. You had to go to OFSA, fight OFSA, deal with OFSA, then go to customs, Nigerian Customs Service, go to the NPA, and so on. So the whole idea of one government, the one government directive, is that government is now looked at as one enterprise. So if you come to OFSA and we require you to bring a document from DPR or from the Nigerian Customs Service, you will not have to go there. We will do that on your behalf because it is one government. And the fourth plank had to do with the entry experience of visitors and travelers who come into Nigeria. Of course, I believe that basically has to do with some other agency like the immigration, not directly something to do with my agency. The fifth plank had to do with ports operations. Again, that had to also do with the Nigerian Ports Authority and other agencies who interface with the NPA in the management of our ports. So then we concentrated on the plans that concerns the oil and gas, the free zones authority.
Mr. Umana,
the three plans, first three plans, transparency, then default approval, which has to do with efficiency, then one government. And what steps did we really
Mr. Umana,
take,
just a quick one here. Thank you. We appreciate all that you've said, explaining the executive order number one and all this. But look at the PEBEC ranking of GOVSA as the best government agency. What does this really mean moving forward for your agency? Because I'm sure he said that to whom much is given, much more is expected. So what does this mean for you, what the PEBEC ranking or award recently given to your free zone authority?
Yes, thank you very much. For me and my team, we're fulfilled because it took a lot of hard work, a lot of commitments, and really, you know, the award measures compliance with the implementation of the directives. So for us to be ranked number one, it means we came tops in the implementation of the directives of the executive order in terms of compliance. So it means a lot. And I was also going to say that we had to work with other government agencies like the Nigerian Customs Service, because to clear cargoes within a time frame of 48 hours, we had a meeting, a tripartite meeting of the authority, the Nigerian Customs Service, and the Immigration Service. And we said to operate as one government, if we must provide efficient services for our clients in the free zones, when requests come in, OXA will deal with these requests within 24 hours. And then the documents will go to the customs for approval, and customs too will be expected within 24 hours to deal with the approval, so a maximum of 48 hours. This has worked, so I must also commend the Nigerian Customs Service for their effective collaboration, which has made the one government policy of the Ease of Doing Business directive to work very effectively in our free zones. So what this means also is that the reforms of the federal government of Nigeria are taking roots, because if you find government agencies like the Oil and Gas Resource Authority, the Nigerian Customs Service, keeping to timelines they have specified, that they have uploaded on their websites, it means there's a shift in attitudes, in policy, and the reforms are taking roots, and of course the impact is being felt. The testimonies from our clients, our licensees in the zones, they speak volumes about how they feel about these changes.
Okay, Mr. Omana, the government is looking to decongest Lagos and try to push a number of the shipping, maritime, whatever, out of Lagos because of the road, whatever congestion. So, do you see more business coming your way down there at One and down south the Niger Delta area of oil and gas with this initiative of decongesting the Lagos ports, the Apapa ports, Tinkan, Roro, and the rest? Do you have future plans for some businesses coming your way?
Yes, I believe so. It should be a natural outcome of what is going on now. If Lagos has a problem of capacity, I believe that we are one country, so we should be looking at alternative locations in terms of also providing the capacity, the structures for other ports that can help in the decongestion of the port in Lagos. And the One port, which is a component of the free trade zone, I believe can come in very handy. I've told you about how efficiently we run our operations. It would take just 48 hours. And this impacts very positively on the industry. Because if they're waiting to clear an equipment that they need urgently for production offshore, if it takes weeks, you are talking about costs. So, but if it takes just 48 hours, it means our contribution to the economy is significant, and it adds up. It certainly must add up. So I believe that at this time we should be looking at other ports. If the problem is about draft, NPA should be take necessary steps to dredge other ports so that the problem of congestion in Lagos can be addressed.
Mr. Omana Okonumana, thank you very much for your time today. The Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer at Oil and Gas Free Zone Authority. Thank you so much, live to us from our Abuja studios. We wish you all the best. Let's take a break. We're back into the marketplace.